Under the cloak of night, Maison Tower stands as a silent sentinel in the heart of the city, a testament to grandeur and ambition. Bathed in the faint glow of scattered lights and supported by majestic marble pillars, the Greek Revival facade exudes an aura of enduring legacy, as if carved to withstand the passage of millennia. A sweeping staircase cascades gracefully from the recessed vestibule, leading into an enormous plaza before continuing down to the vacant street of a slumbering city. At first glance, the building might evoke the solemn dignity of a courthouse, but the aureate epigraph of the name Maison in the stone edifice would betray that pretense. The rest of the tower's architecture doesn't even try to make such an attempt, reaching boldly into the black sky with sleek lines and geometric patterns only seen in the gilded glory of the Art Deco style. But despite this ostentatious presentation, it was just another building made of glass and steel. Like gold leaf, void of any substance beyond the veneer. Only shadows were left at play within these empty halls, dancing in what few specks of light mark the endless expanse of the tower. It is behind this masquerade of indulgent pretension and beyond the expanse of studios and offices, of printing presses and mailrooms, where Maison's true substance lies. For just beneath its spire sits a suite that houses its one and only mastermind, the very brain that conceived and designed its splendor for all the world to see. Ashton H. Upman sits at his desk, immutably scratching away with a golden fountain pen at some document. Without even a pause, Ashton H. Upman's gravelly voice calls out to an obscured presence lurking in the unseen, somewhere just beyond the cracked open doors to his parlor. It's rude to just stand there and say nothing, you know. But there is no response. With a huff, Upman turns the page of his work over and sets down his pen, finally lifting his head to meet the enigmatic phantom awaiting invitation. Just who the hell are you? The figure shrouded in black draws upon the threshold, as if one of the shadows took form and moved into the light, making itself welcome in the president's personal chambers. With the tipping of its wide-brimmed hat, the identity of this intruder comes to be known. Standing before Upman is none other than Dr. Elfman von Weirdscience.
Mine apologies for so rudely imposing.
He enters with a bow. A small chuckle escapes his weathered and rough throat.
But I believe we have important business to discuss. I don't discuss business with strangers.
Upman grumbles to his dark visitor as he lights a cigar for himself. The disgruntled businessman looks his intrusive guest up and down, locking eyes with an unacquainted adversary.
Besides, what business could we possibly have?
I embarrass myself yet again.
The scientist apologizes with excess humility, though to Upman it was all a flagrant performance. A smile never left the mad doctor's face.
You must forgive me. I spend so much time with uncouth and unsavory men, Herr Upman.
He removes his hat as a gesture of goodwill before formally introducing himself.
My name is Dr. Elfman von Weirdscience, a scientist in the employ of the United States government. The rabble I mentioned are the very same assassins, I believe, you are already intimately familiar with.
The president callously puffs a perfect ring of smoke in his visitor's direction, who bats it away with a cough.
Ah,
Upman acknowledges as he reclines in his chair.
In other words, you are the thorn in my paw.
Ignoring his host's hostility, Weirdscience continues as he meanders further away from the smoke.
To call them assassins would be too much. La Cantina is more of a research program. You see, the psychoactive drugs that ruined your body and caused so many of deine employees to leave would be my creation. And somehow it landed in your editor-in-chief's hands. I wish to know how. Didn't Dior tell you herself?
The pervasive smile on the doctor's face grows as if to hide the frustration evident in his speech. Upman could even catch a glimpse of a grimace behind the intruder's tinted glasses.
Therein lies the problem. We have your Duffy in captivity, but he refuses to talk, no matter the methods we employ to encourage him. Truly, he is a resilient specimen.
Upman scoffs.
Are you sure we're talking about the same Duffy?
The doctor paces even faster, wringing his hands in evident exasperation.
Physical torture did nothing. Electrotherapy couldn't coax an answer from him. Even the lobotomies failed to produce results. I'm afraid at this point we have broken the poor fool. He is nothing but a wheelchair-bound vegetable at this point. His secrets locked in an impenetrable fortress.
The cigar almost slips from the president's mouth, aghast at the casual barbarism his guest willfully admitted to.
You're a goddamn monster,
Upman scowls, sitting up straight in his throne.
I'm familiar with your kind. Back when I served in the Great War, I killed my fair share of krauts, I'll have you know. You drag any of that blood into my domain, and I won't hesitate to get my hands dirty again.
Weird Science delights at the threat.
Such intimidation! And all for a degenerate photographer you threw away like garbage.
Thoroughly amused, the deranged tyrant can't help but laugh. He suppresses the urge after a few stray squeals make it through his teeth.
But that is not why you are truly so roused to anger. Is it?
The madman turns his attention to an ornate globe half as tall as he is, his slender fingers tracing the orb until he lands on his mother country.
Upman is a German name, is it not? I know many families in America returned to serve their motherland, but clearly not you. The drums of war called you to march against your own. Where is deine pride for Deutschland?
Unfazed, Upman waves off the question without hesitation or consideration.
I may be German by design, but what I've accomplished I did as an American businessman. I didn't fight them directly, but I did my part when we entered the Second War.
With the same hand that dismissed his heritage, he points his cigar with an accusatory finger at the unwelcome guest.
You, on the other hand, oh, I bet your hands are filthier than anyone else's. And I don't shake hands with Nazi scum.
With rubbery black gloves, the wretched doctor playfully spins the globe and allows it to come to rest on its own momentum. Meanwhile, his eyes wander about the room to absorb its decor. Glittering ornaments of brass and antique trophies pervade the expansive office of Maison's magnate, the crimson furniture only becoming apparent to the doctor as he tips his similarly colored spectacles.
Pennsylvania cherrywood,
he notes in admiration.
All of it American-made.
A genuine but sinister smile cracks through the madman's purple lips, revealing a row of teeth sharpened to a dagger-like point. Behind this barbed cage, his tongue flicks in anticipation of spitting venomous invectives.
You are not the only one with praise for the American government and its workings. Without your CIA, I would have rotted away in a prison cell. And now mine filthy hands are at work once again.
He salutes as an American soldier would his flag.
Truly, Gott mit Amerika.
However, Upman merely scoffs at this attempted derision.
I don't expect everyone in this country to measure up to my greatness,
he rebukes in vainglory.
What I've built is my own legacy. In the end, I'm just a single golden thread in the great American tapestry. You are merely a blemish. Pride cometh before the fall, Herr Upman.
The sinister scientist tuts with a finger.
And I am no stranger to it. I have a certain pride myself. Pride in mine science. Mine work.
Weird Science lifts both of his hands to the light and sinks into the waters of nostalgia, reliving his glory days. As if driven by instinct, those very hands begin to pantomime the gruesome events he begins recalling.
How filthy they are, yes. These hands have cracked open skulls, toiled through brain matter, and sacrificed countless lives to the altar of science. No, not for the Reich. I did it for the satisfaction of mine own curiosity.
Unbothered by the macabre narrative, or perhaps unwilling to let it show, the company president returns the cigar to his mouth and casts forth a vacant stare. Weird Science doesn't let the silence deter him from extolling his atrocities. He didn't need or desire permission.
I should have hanged for it, but I wasn't punished for this excessive pride. Don't you know why? Mine research was simply too valuable. A single American soldier found my lab and stole mine journals for himself. The tribunal at Nuremberg could not prove their accusations enough to warrant mine execution. And when the American government took me from mine cell and gave me mine own laboratory here in San Francisco, that little soldier came crawling back.
The rambling madman approaches Upman and firmly presses his hands flat upon his desk. The ever-present smile that had been on his face fades for the first time as his voice descends into grim and surly tones.
I hate loose ends, Herr Upman. They are bad for my research. A scientific experiment requires an experimental und control group. If mine research falls out of mine hands...
He trails, standing back with a shrug and straightening his tightly bound lab coat.
Well, I must do what I must to keep my results pure and uncontaminated. Surely you can see the merits in that.
That soldier, then?
Torn to shreds and sunken to the bottom of the San Francisco Bay. Then was this all some sort of long-winded, elaborate threat? Because I'm not very moved by it. Air, Weird Science.
The doctor shakes his head at the notion.
Let us not be fooled into thoughtlessly waving someone else's flag. We are our own men. In light of that, I believe we can come to some sort of mutual arrangement. I am not here to fight or argue. I am merely bargaining for consolation.
The tension in the office doesn't entirely dissipate, but lessens just enough for Upman to entertain his guest's proposition. The president groans as he rises from his throne, casually strolling toward his newly refreshed bar. He humors the scientist with his usual sense of hospitality.
What is a business deal without a drink? It's as you said, there may be some German blood in me yet, some customs worth keeping. The drink is your choice.
I was just about to ask.
Weird Science smiles as he is offered to take a seat in an upholstered armchair across the president's desk. He accepts the invitation.
An amaretto and soda over ice, if you please. This a little lemon.
Upman reaches for his top-shelf Luxardo amaretto, all the while watching his adversary's reflection in the glass sheen of his collection. The president pours the first drink, remarking in sarcasm as thick as syrup.
Such a refined palate.
Weird Science makes himself comfortable in anticipation of a more pleasant conversation, crossing his legs and weaving his fingers together in his lap.
You see, I believe you can help me solve my predicament. I simply want to recover the information that belongs to me.
What makes you think I can help you?
Upman interjects as he takes a paring knife in hand and strips the flesh from a single lemon. He grips the blade firmly, all the while keeping his eyes on his adversary's reflection.
If you want to rifle through Duffy's office, knock yourself out. I barely have enough people to run my magazine, much less keep track of his mess.
It was never my intention to interfere in deine business, Herr Upman.
No!
Upman barks as he swiftly returns to hand his guest their requested cocktail. Posturing himself high above Weird Science, the president takes his seat not in his leather throne, but atop the corner of his desk.
You just tried to destroy the building and kill everyone inside.
Weird Science holds his glass out to Upman, offering an unspoken toast. A small gesture to remind the host of his hospitable disposition.
I am hoping we can put that past behind us,
he implores. Though hesitating, Upman ultimately accedes, gently knocking their glasses together. The doctor nods silently, allowing the crystal cups to finish their song, and takes a confident sip from his tumbler.
All that I request is the surrender of just one more of your employees.
The company president pauses before the glass reaches his lips, shooting a knowing glare to his demanding guest. Weird Science pays it no mind.
I am under the impression that your secretary has a vacant to a stand that can probe the mind and uncover the very secrets I am after. All I want is Mina Moore. Once I have her, I will leave the rest of Maison to you and your iron fist.
Peering quietly from the edge of the entryway, a demure figure is eclipsed by mammoth cherrywood doors and ensconced in shadow. Mina Moore cups her mouth to silence her reaction, waiting with bated breath for Upman's response. The old man doesn't even flinch, his glower burning hotter than hell itself as all of the insults pile into his heart like coal.
No deal,
Upman responds curtly, putting as much power behind each word as he possibly could. In one fluid motion, the president downs his drink and slams the glass upon the table so hard one would be surprised it didn't break.
Mina is far too valuable to me. You can see yourself out.
The host slides off the edge of his desk and begins making the journey to his chair when Weird Science rises and objects.
I'm afraid you don't understand, Herr Upman. This was all a formality. You see, La Cantina is the name of a research program. I told you as much. What I was hoping you would understand is...
He lingers, basking in the pause before he unveils his sinister design.
The moment you were dosed with my creation, you were already part of that experiment. Both you and Mina Moore are my property.
Before the old man can make it to his leather throne, a searing pain in his chest takes hold and trips his next step. Upman stumbles into his chair, hardly able to draw breath, and undoes the cravat choking at his windpipe in hopes of finding more air.
What did you do?
He chokes out in accusation.
You have no choice but to reconsider.
Weird Science admonishes as he wanders about the chamber.
You're not in a strong bargaining position. You see, only I can rid you of the poison you just drank.
It was only then that Upman noticed the miniature silver tool spinning between the doctor's fingers.
Have you heard of a physicist named James Clerk Maxwell? He once proposed a most fascinating thought experiment.
Weird Science lectures, occupying his dominant hand with a dexterous trick as the argent instrument dances about his fingers. In fact, what first looks like a metal pipe seems to grow in size with each rotation, its true form becoming more and more evident.
Consider that heat is merely the byproduct of molecular agitation. Imagine two connecting rooms and a microscopic creature. If this Klein demon were to open the door between them, entropy dictates that their temperatures would reach a state of equilibrium. However, violating the laws of thermodynamics as we know it, this creature instead divides the particles, making one room hot as a desert and the other as cold as a tundra. We call this creature Maxwell's demon.
Now resting on Weird Science's shoulder is an enormous war hammer gleaming under the office lights, embossed arrows leading up and down the mallet.
The redistribution of energy and matter. That is the principle behind Maxwell's silver hammer.
Upman can hardly squeeze out any words, but his eyes are full of confusion as he desperately grips at the armrests of his chair. His saboteur understands such an expression perfectly well and explains.
Much like apples and arsenic, cherrywood contains trace amounts of cyanide. When collected together, they become a lethal dose. I simply transferred that cyanide into your drink when we toasted. Cyanide smells of almonds. The amaretto.
The weakening president somehow sputters, deducing that the aromatic drink masked the presence of the poison within.
122.7 milligrams of cyanide would kill a man of your stature in 10 very generous minutes. Of course, I can remove the poison, but only if you fully cooperate with my demands. Be a good patient, Herr Upman. We don't have all the time in the world.
Within the silence, Weird Science could swear he heard the rustling of some continuous stream, like flowing water. The source was before his eyes the entire time, for sitting on the president's desk was an ornate hourglass, countless granules of sand falling into the glass basin. The doctor knew right away that his adversary's stand was at work, and so he takes an abrupt and violent step away from his victim. When his eyes return to the president, he is met with the same glower from before, but without even a blink to interrupt it. Upman remains slouched in his chair, unmoving, but still somehow holding that same infernal ember kindled in his eyes.
He can't already be dead, Weird Science wonders. Is he playing, kid?
The doctor reaches for his own glass of amaretto and tosses the remaining ice from the cup. Holding the glass to the floor, he places his ear upon the other end and listens intently. In the silent stillness of the room, radiating from the old man's heart to the tips of his toes through to the floorboards, is the life-giving organ's faint beating. Slow, but still detectable.
I know all about time in a bottle, thanks to Dior, but to think you'd slow the beating of thine own heart to moderate the spreading of the poison. Your fortitude is admirable, Herr Upman.
The tyrant bats away the desk with an effortless swing and readies his warhammer, gripping it tightly with his gloved hands.
But prolonging the inevitable is all you can accomplish. You are too weak, Herr Upman. You can hardly protect your own life, much less your little secretary. Rest assured, I will find and capture this Fraulein myself.
The silver weapon glints as it comes crashing down. But before it reaches its target, the shrill screaming of Mina Moore interrupts.
No!
She squeals as she throws herself in harm's way. Maxwell's silver hammer stops mere inches from crashing down upon the valiant young woman's dome.
No, Mina.
Upman moans.
Why didn't you stay hidden?
He won't hurt me!
Mina declares in confidence.
If he wants me so badly, he can't do anything to me! All you need to do is make it to Theo and you'll be okay!
The young woman promises. She looks behind with a smile to the man she has served for the past year and reassures his worries.
Don't worry about me! It's time I take care of them!
But Mina was unable to deliver the sentiment, as the silver mallet of their enemy crashes into her regardless. Flung across the room, Mina lands upon the standing bar, shattering bottles and splintering the wood.
Do not be mistaken.
The twisted tyrant grumbles with ire as he takes steady steps toward his prey.
You are useful to me, but I do not care about your well-being, Mina Moore.
Though the young lady was struck with such a devastating weapon, it was only with enough force to injure, not to kill. She defiantly struggles to lift her face to meet her attacker, but hasn't quite the strength left to accomplish such resistance. Weird Science points the end of his weapon at her and threatens.
You don't need your legs. All I need is your brain. And if you continue to be so uncooperative, that is all you will have left.
A footstep from behind Weird Science thrusts a chill into the doctor, who slowly cranes his head to see none other than Upman himself, standing upright and making his way toward the mad doctor.
My life is forfeit, Mina,
the president argues.
But as long as I'm alive, you work for me, understand? Listen and obey my orders.
Mr. Upman!
Mina whimpers, succumbing to the tears welling up behind her doe-like eyes.
Please! You have to keep using time in a bottle on yourself! You'll die in minutes without it!
Even sooner!
Weird Science promises, crashing his weapon atop the stubborn president.
Yeah.
The silver mallet gleams as it soars through the air, but as if hitting an invisible barrier, it comes to a standstill before reaching its target.
What? You enjoy these kinds of lectures, don't you?
Upman admonishes as he makes his way toward Mina.
I'm sure a man like you has heard of Achilles' paradox. By feeding the sands of time into your hammer, I double the time it takes to get halfway to striking me. In other words, your hammer will never reach me.
Though he understands the principle, Weird Science refuses to believe his adversary and swings again and again at the company president standing protectively before Mina. Each time, his weapon stops short of reaching its mark.
But how? Time in a bottle can only work with 60 minutes advance. You would need an infinite source of time to accomplish that.
His answer arrives in the form of a large slate of the ceiling crashing down upon him. With no time to react, Weird Science is flattened underneath the rubble, a splash of his blood spraying Upman and Mina and staining the precious Ottoman rug beneath him.
That should be the last of him.
The president offers a hand to pull Mina from the ground, pleading,
"Let's get you up, okay?"
But before it could be done, a flash freeze rips through the floorboards and reaches with an icy hand to seize the president and his secretary. Upman pulls the young woman into his arms and up from the path of danger as his legs are frozen stiff in ice.
Mr. Upman!
Mina cries. The president follows the path of ice as it points back to the doctor's silver stand, his severed arm still gripping the weapon tightly. His lifeless form twitches and somehow finds an escape from underneath the rubble. All of the crimson liquid returns to Weird Science as his flesh is reconstituted back into a recognizable form.
You don't need an infinite source of time. Just one that would ensure our mutual destruction.
The immortal monster realizes as he rolls his freshly repaired neck.
And so you are taking the time away from the very building we are standing in and infinitely cycling it to mein hammer. Very clever.
Grabbing his weapon tightly once again, Weird Science reveals with a sinister smirk.
Unfortunately for you, as long as mein hand remains on Maxwell's silver hammer, I will always be reborn.
With one final push, the doctor swings his hammer, connecting with an invisible barrier of infinite time. No matter how much force he exerts, he cannot break through. But much to Upman's surprise, he somehow finds a way to press beyond the barricade, if not by a hair's breadth.
Temperature, body parts, stands, or even time itself. Mein hammer can redistribute every form of energy.
As the silver mallet inches closer and closer, Weird Science can't help but brag, his shining smile almost as bright as his weapon.
I can absorb all of this time and turn it against you, and with just one touch, I will turn you into dust, so easily swept away by the wind and forgotten. 100 years, 200, 500, 1,000.
Upman counts as if taking note of the passage of time. Drained by the company president of its future, Maison Tower itself begins to wither. The books in his personal library crumble like dried out pastries, and every drop of alcohol in his bar evaporates almost instantly. Creeping vines begin to take their hold, and millennia seem to pass for the bones of the tower.
5,000 years! Long after I've turned to dust, my legacy will persist!
What are you?
I have a plan, Mina,
he mutters to his secretary.
And as long as I'm alive, you'll do as I ask, yes? You are my secretary.
Of course, Mr. Upman, but...
The window shatters beside Mina, causing her to yelp and huddle against her boss's chest for comfort. The old man takes her by the shoulders and looks deep into her eyes.
Use your stand to take what's on the forefront of my mind. Once you have my plan of action, you'll know what must be done.
The hammer inches closer and closer to the company president, and Mina nods. She knows there is little time to argue, and Upman is doing all he can to buy them that time. A shambling mechanical man appears from behind Mina and retrieves an 8-track tape from their respective minds. As the tape clicks into place, Mina's eyes flit back and forth as if watching a film at double speed, and the truth of her boss's plan finally sinks in.
Oh no!
Mina objects, clawing at Upman to reconsider.
No, not like this! I don't want it to be this way!
Miss Moore.
The president interrupts, firmly grasping his protege by the tuft of her blouse.
You'll be hearing from my lawyer.
She didn't have another second to argue. In the next moment, Mina is pushed out of the shattered window and ejected from the crumbling tower. As the young woman plummets to the stone below, she does so as softly, gently, and as slowly as possible. A small token of salvation gifted to her by time in a bottle, now a permanent fixture in her own soul. Tears well up in her eyes as the top floor of the penthouse collapses before her, and words once uttered silently in Upman's mind begin to resound in her own.
Do you think I fear death, Mina? Oh, please. Pain is beauty, remember? I welcome it. I beg for it. Not because I wish to die, but because I look forward to making that last flash in the pan as bright as it can be, to blind the world with my magnificence. So don't mourn me. Don't mourn Maison. Don't mourn the tower. I'm just a grown child playing with toys, Mina. I built it all up out of matchsticks because I want to see how bright it burns when I set it on fire. That's all I've done with my life. Building the kindling, And now you can add to that pile. Because when I'm gone, you will inherit all of it. The name Maison is worth more than a tower of glass and steel. I hope the title of president doesn't burden you too much. If it does, then light the match right now and set it ablaze. It won't matter to me. I'll be dead. But I'll know. In this moment, I'll know that the name is in good hands. I'll know that Maison will have left behind a permanent mark on the world. Even after it's gone. After I'm gone.
Mr. Olivia!
The girl whispers in disbelief. The golden edifice collapses from the facade of the tower as the rest of it surrenders to the earth from whence it came. Soaring high above the devastation, unable to reach the floating secretary, Theodore escapes with his new companion rendered into a makeshift parachute, gracing the top of a building not quite as tall as Maison used to be.
Mina!
He screams, but the young woman vanishes in the cloud of dust hovering at ground level. Still, he braves the danger and takes Mickey in hand once more.
You don't mind, do you?
He asks, but doesn't wait for an answer before leaping into the cloud. The miasma of destruction makes it hard to see his own hand before his face, and Theodore is forced to cover his mouth with the jabot adorning his neck. Still, he coughs as he begins the search, crying out her name in the intervals, but to no avail. The designer staggers aimlessly through the dust until he stumbles upon two enormous figures in the fog. The Goliath servants of the Mad Doctor, known as the Fortunate Sons. The first of them towers over the slender dandy like a massive brick wall he just walked into, Mina held captive under his arm. The other giant pulls his master from out of the rubble as the Doctor's disparate body parts find their way back and reattach themselves surrounding the hand still gripping his hammer. Now standing alongside his creations, Weird Science smiles happily upon his winnings.
Don't you touch her!
Theodore's voice erupts through the dust. Another piece of rubble falls through the clouds, a partition of concrete separating the zealous tailor from his goal. Were it any closer, he would have been crushed. But his own safety was the last thing from Theodore's mind. With the swiping of sharp-dressed man's claws, the slab of stone is cut down to size and the dust blasted away. But it was too late. Theodore stood in the plaza, alone. Despite the collective efforts of Maison, the young Mina has fallen into the grasps of an unconscionable enemy. Echoes of a long-buried tragedy repeat endlessly in a nightmare. The sound of police sirens blared atop the scene of a fiery wreck on an endless stretch of highway. Souped-up junkers for street racing lay wrapped around telephone poles and violently twisted beyond recognition. Some of the screams managed to break through, imprinting themselves eternally in Calvin James's mind.
Get out of here, Cal!
One of them insisted.
Save yourself!
Another implored. He could only watch as the car he was ejected from caught fire in the next moment, incinerating his friends still trapped within. Calvin was lucky to survive. The only permanent damage, a scar crossing his left eyebrow. At least, the only damage visible. As the lone survivor of his crew, Calvin would be forced to bear an unrelenting ache in his soul, throbbing in pain with the coming of each day. On that warm summer night in 1957, a joyride that turned into a police chase would mark the end of the roadster's life as he knew it and signal the beginning of a brand new one.
Greyhound!
A voice calls out, breaking through the nightmare. Calvin shoots up from a lumpy cot to find himself in a cold jail cell. The cell door has long since been removed, but it was hardly a comfort as the rest of the bars remained. At the end of the day, he and the rest of his La Cantina brethren were still prisoners in this place.
It is Calvin.
The hungover wretch mutters as he sits himself upright, reaching for a nearby flask. A stick of Bazooka Joe gum falls from the pocket of his leather jacket and lands on the floor, giving the miserable man pause.
Well, that's what the doctor calls you,
his visitor insists. Calvin barely moves his eyes to take in exactly who is speaking to him, casting them instead toward the stone floor, where his one remaining token from Mickey Finn lies. But he can make out his visitor by their tone of voice. Standing by what is left of the cell bars is Angostura, the miniature new recruit to La Cantina. But the hapless sod doesn't respond. He simply keeps drinking.
Weird Science is coming back. Figured you'd want to know that. Make yourself decent.
Oh, just leave him like that.
Another voice suggests, cutting through the darkened corner of an adjacent cell. Cast in shadow, a conspicuous feminine voice harshly mocks her supposed leader.
Ever since his gay little friend kicked the bucket, he's been like this. Given enough time, he'll just die on his own.
The argument is interrupted by the sudden clamor of a large iron door. A beam of light cracks into the dimly lit cell block, causing Calvin to avert his eyes as it floods and fills the room. Weird Science steps through with his fresh captive in tow, bound by the hands and mouth. The tyrant ultimately stops before the cell of his most whipped and obedient lackey.
Clean yourself up, Greyhound. We have work to do.
He spits in disgust. The doctor turns to face yet another of his experiments, craning his head to the cell of the very woman who is mocking the already defeated dog.
I hope you appreciate my token of gratitude. Soon we will see if deine information was correct, Miss Dior Lancome.
The light of the open door casts upon the face of a striking young woman with golden blonde hair that curls as it hits her shoulders. The spitting image of the vintage Maison pinup calendar she keeps on the wall. With her hand resting on her chin, Dior bears the most self-satisfied smile, as if she were in absolute control of the world around her. But Weird Science corrects his mistake, insisting on a new epithet for the vixen.
Nein, Brandy Alexander.